you are listening to is Imam Muhammad Afi. Imam Afi is the leader of Muslims in the metropolitan Washington, D.C. area. He previously led the Israeli and Jumu'ah prayers inside the Islamic Center. His teachings were inspiring, revolutionary, and thought-provoking, which eventually irritated and threatened the Middle East ambassador to control the Damascus. Finally, the Imam, the Sharia, and other Muslims faithful to the cause of Islam were forced out into the streets. This khutbah originates from the sidewalk across the street from the Islamic Center, apparently under siege.
الحمد لله الحمد لله رب العالمين نحمده بما هو أهله إن الحمد لله الحمد لله كما ينبغي لجلال وجهه وعظيم سلطانه الحمد لله الذي هدانا سبلنا يا رب لك الحمد في السراء والضراء وحين البأس اللهم إنك أنت الأول وأنت الآخر اللهم إنك أنت الظاهر وأنت الباطن تهدي من تشاء إلى صراط مستقيم قل إن الهدى هدى الله إنك لا تهدي من أحببت ولكن الله يهدي من يشاء وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له إن الحكم إلا لله أمر أن لا تعبدوا إلا إياه ذلك الدين القيم ولكن أكثر الناس لا يعلمون وأشهد أن سيدنا ومولانا وحبيب قلوبنا وقرة عيوننا وصفوة نفوسنا وعزيز أرواحنا محمدا صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم عبده ورسوله وما كان الله ليعذبهم وأنت فيهم وما كان الله ليعذبهم وهم يستغفرون ما آتاكم الرسول فخذوه وما نهاكم عنه فانتهوا فيطع الله ورسوله وأولي الأمر من المؤمنين فلا يضل أبدا. ومن يعص الله ورسوله وأولي الأمر من المؤمنين فلا يهدى أبدا. ومن يتوكل على الله فإن الله على كل شيء قدير. Committed Muslim, one of the leading indications of where we stand in our present day circumstances and conditions, if we take a closer look at ourselves, we find, and this is a difficult thing to confess to, but it's the truth. And the sooner we recognize the truth, the more Asian we are, and the less of time it will take to surmount the difficulty that we identify. This difficulty that lives in us and lives with us is our inability to have the confidence that Allah expects of us. There is undoubtedly a crisis of confidence in the Muslims of yesteryear and in the Muslims of today. And this crisis of confidence is a complex one, it's not a simple one, because there are many contributories to it. And it just did not begin all of a sudden, perchance, randomly, and haphazardly. We can trace this assault on the confidence level of the Muslim rank and file. We can trace that all the way back to the founding years of Allah's Prophet, may Allah's blessings and peace be his. One of the most telling lessons of this crisis of confidence is represented by the issue in the time of Allah's Prophet of the Muslim's Qibla. They seem to be confused at one time, facing towards Mecca, at another time, facing towards Al-Quds, Jerusalem. And immediately, the eternal enemies of Allah picked up on this, and then they alluded to the confused leadership that the Muslims had, i.e., Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This was an early attempt at undermining and destroying the confidence that Muslims have, and particularly the confidence that Muslims have in their leadership. And it took a while. Azza wa Jal who revealed words of scripture that we are supposed to understand, to say to his prophet that this issue of Al-Quds and Mecca was an issue to purify the Islamic rank and file on one hand, by screening those Muslims who are solidly committed to the Islamic leadership from those Muslims who waver and they change at a flip of a coin. On one hand, and on the other hand, it is an incentive to the external enemies of the Islamic order to come out with their internal thoughts and their internal feelings towards the leadership of Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the Muslims withered that crisis of confidence. And then, as the event unfolded, another opportunity was grabbed by Allah's enemies and his prophet's enemies. This is what they do. Every occasion they may have, they will grab it to try to undermine and to decrease or diminish the level of confidence that Muslims have in Allah, in his prophet, in the leadership of the committed Muslims. When Allah's prophet came back from the journey referred to as al-Isra and al-Mi'raj, once again, these same sources of hostility to Allah and his prophet and the base of committed Muslims came out again. And I told the Muslims, do you believe this man? He says he has gone from Mecca to Al-Quds to Jerusalem in one night and then he came back. And all of you know that it takes us about 1 month to travel this distance. How can this be? How can this person be telling the truth? If you suspect what he is saying concerning these words that come to him from God, now he has given us proof that he is a forgery, that he is not authentic, that he is not telling the truth. These prophets were saying to the Muslim rank and file, your prophet is a liar. And on this occasion, there were some Muslims who said, we can't believe this. And they withdrew their allegiance and their support and their commitment to the Prophet. In other words, they renounced their Islam.
And who is left? The devastated, the defiled, the committed, the sincere and honest Muslim. But in all of this, living, what cannot be denied is that there was a crisis of confidence within the Muslim mind and within Muslim society. And there has been a disconnect from those events to the events of our time. Even then, the same issues are still alive. Who can deny from among the Muslims? Who can deny that there is a crisis of confidence in the minds and in the communities of today's Muslims? Who can deny that? You come to these Muslims who are Muslims of convenience, who are Muslims of culture, who are Muslims of coin. You come to them and you say, this is what Allah is telling you. This is what Allah expects of you. And you may quote a few ayahs from the Quran. And one of these examples is to quote to them the responsibilities of Muslims in taking the military initiative against their enemies. وَقَاتِلُوا الْمُشْرِكِينَ كَافَّةً كَمَا يُقَاتِلُونَكُمْ كَافَّةً. And initiate an all-out warfare against the mushrik the same way the mushriks have initiated an all-out warfare against you. Now come, let us look at the world in light of what Allah Jalla wa Ala is saying to us. Is it not true that the Muslims have garnered all of their forces, have mustered all of their resources, have put together all of their forces, and then we see the consequences of what is happening to the Muslims? If we are listening to Allah, we should understand that the response of this is to have a thorough, all-out, total, exhaustive mobilization of Islamic resources, Islamic manpower, Islamic potential against this combined spirit of difference. But we don't even have ulama, scholars who are capable of ascending the main battle and then explaining these thoughts to the Muslim public. Next week, there's going to be a summit at Camp David. The Yahudi, the Mushrik, the Munafiq heads are going to meet Barak and Arafat and Clinton. They're going to meet at Camp David. To do what? To see to it that justice is done? No. They are to try to pay a fast run on the Muslims. And in preparation for that, they are going to release some prisoners from detention centers in the occupied lands.
over the course of a charade of returning a few villages and a piece of land back to its rightful owner. And then they are going to say that they are ready for peace. But how and where is this scenario unfolding? There's a larger context in which these same enemies of the prophet, the enemies of our days, are working today. What are they doing? They have now put together six committees. Six Yahudi committees to reclaim and Masjid al-Aqsa. To say that it belongs to them and doesn't belong to the Muslims. These committees are even busy finding a currency of their own. A currency within a currency of seed, of Yahudi seed. And all of this currency has a treasury. But they say, will support their effort of retaking what they call is the Temple Mount area on which they will build the third temple. All of this is taking place when Arabian governments are issuing visas to Yahoo. A few months ago, 800 Yahudis went from all stolen lands in Palestine. They were given visas by the Tunisian government to go and celebrate in one of their strongholds called Jarda in Tunisia. The Yemeni government said it is normalizing religious relations with the Yahudis. That's the first step on the long road to normalizing fraternal relations and social relations with Yahudis. And they also are saying to them, you may come back. There was a major Yahudi movement from Yemen to Palestine in the 40s and 50s. Tens of thousands of them relocated. Now the Yemeni government is telling Yahudi, you may come back. But is the illegal and illegitimate Zionist Israeli Jewish government telling the Palestinians, you may also come back, no. But where is the confidence? It may be too much to ask Muslims to look at these events. Because sometimes it's hard to come by the past that has been just spoken. Because there is a calculated amount of information that is sent to the public that supports the status quo in the making. It may be too much to ask the average Muslim to breach these issues. But how about those who are supposed to know better? Those who are in positions of knowledge and information, especially those who are supposed to be the ulama of the Muslims, the scholars of Islam, where are they on these issues? And when you take a second look at it, you find there is a crisis of confidence. They don't have the willpower. They don't have the integrity of thought to look at these issues in this perspective. In the meantime, these Yehudi criminals, remember, they sell themselves to the religious components of society as being the extension of Israeli history. And they are a forgery of that history. Or else, and this is an area that no one wants to look at, they're officials, they're corrupt officials. They take their microscope, their informers, their intelligence services to try to dig up any dirt they can on committed Muslims. But when it comes to them, when their scandal and their corruption fill the air with their foul behavior, no one is supposed to identify that. The previous defense minister of Palestine, Israel, of that new state Israel, when he was forced to resign his position in the government as minister of defense, he was forced to do so because of his sexual scandal with women in his office and with women in Babylonia. And then this is supposed to go unnoticed. And then you have the president of that country itself who is refusing bribes and kickback from a French sponsor. The NSO is to resign this week because of this scandal. Remember, these are supposed to be biblical characters, because Israel is shown to the public as a biblical country or a biblical state. And it is the country of Satan, and it is the state of Satan himself. One of the officials, and this is also a very small news item, and because of the crisis of Muslim conscience, we don't have one of who can diffuse this information and make it public knowledge to all and sundry. One of their officials in one of their embassies in Brazil, in Latin America, was recalled because he was involved in a pornographic scene in which he was taking young boys and girls and subjecting them to sexual abuse. Imagine if this was the other way around. Imagine if this was happening in an Islamic state. The head of the Islamic state has to resign. This is the head of the Jewish state who has to resign. But it's lurking. It's not causing any crisis of confidence in the Yehudi faithful. This is what is happening, and they are not moved by it. They could care less. Because crooks breed more crooks. And in this case, Jewish deviation of behavior brings more Jewish deviation of behavior. Ministers of their government, and the Social Prime Minister in this past year, and his wife, because when they were Prime Ministers, when he was Prime Minister, he was receiving gifts that were supposed to go to the Israeli state, and not to his own pocket, or his own living room. And these investigations go on and on and on, and there's no crisis of conscience in the Yehudi faith. But here we are with the Jewish heart, a Muslim leader who has to step down from the highest office in the land because he is tarnished with scandal and corruption and misbehavior. There's a crisis of conscience in ourselves because we are not able to preempt their strength against us. And with all of this that we have taken and absorbed, They may have broken our hearts. They may have broken our bones. But they haven't broken our spirit. Here they were in southern Lebanon. For 2 decades, fiercely fighting to steal other people's lives and possessions. And now, they had to leave, and they left at night. And when they left, it disoriented them. Now, in these northern villages in Palestine, occupied by these Yahoos, they sent their children to school in armored buses. This is how vulnerable and fragile they are. Many of them moved from northern Palestine to southern Palestine because they didn't want to stay in place of committed Muslims. And this is only the taste of things to come. And they see that Muslims are bringing confidence. True, we have a crisis of confidence, but it is on its way out. Muslims are gaining confidence. They are gaining this confidence where? They're not gaining this confidence by shaking Albright's hand, or in the face of Arafat, kissing her hand. That's not the way Muslims are gaining confidence. They are not gaining confidence when they come to Camp David to meet with Mushriks and Kafirs and أَشَدِّ النَّاسِ عَذَاوَةً لِلَّذِينَ آمَنُوا, that's not the way they gain confidence. They don't gain confidence at the negotiating table with a Yahudi intermediary who has been going across the Atlantic for the past 8 years, literally thousands of times. They are gaining confidence by the military successes that have been scored. And looking at these issues in this context, is it surprising to know that that is why they are fierce on the Muslim periphery? In the Muslim heartland, they have agents governments, the rulers, were trying to tame this Islamic movement. Or were trying to obliterate this Islamic movement. This you can see. Just open your eyes and watch what is happening. It's all that is required of you. Think of what is happening to the condition of the Muslims in this world. And let's see how they are acting on the periphery. In Chechnya, in Central Asia, in the past 7 or 8 months, they have rounded up 6 to 8 thousand Muslims just in one republic in Central Asia. And thrown them into prison. And just this past week, these corruptors, corporate interests that roam the globe looking for natural resources to make a kill out of it, a financial kill for themselves, and a biological kill against the local and the native populations of this area. They set the continent of Africa on fire. Literally, this is what is happening in Africa. Almost every area is on fire. And Muslims are not supposed to watch their feet of what is happening there. The same with the Caucasus, over Central Asia. They are setting those areas on fire. And just in this past week, these international prospectors discovered what they say in conservative terms is the 5th largest oil field in the world. And this is a conservative estimate. It may be the 2nd, or the 1st, or the 3rd. And we don't even feel that that belongs to us. An oil field in Kazakhstan that was discovered this past week shall belong to Mobil, to Exxon, to Shell, British Petroleum, Adit, and the rest of these transnational oil companies. And it is in the reverse world, and none of us has the feeling that it belongs to us. Why? Because we are suffering from a crisis of conscience. And the same can be said about the petroleum and the gas station that you fill your car up with gas from. Any Muslim fear that he's filling his tank with gas, that 3/4 of that gas belongs to his ummah? No. And because you don't have just that rudimentary, that simple notion, or that feeling, not only did they occupy and steal your resources, they occupied and stole your mind. This is where the Muslims are trying to recover and make a comeback. And the Muslims are not alone in this world. There are oppressed people who share the same plight and the same destiny that the Muslims have. Is it no wonder that there are alerts that go out from the Yahudi State Department here in Washington to American citizens around the world to keep a low profile? They are surprised because of the policies of the United States, because of the Yahudis who are driving this country into the abyss. There may be free souls out there. These may not necessarily be Muslims, but people who can see the thought and reality as it is, not a distorted reality. The reality that is presented to you, whether it's from the window, or whether it's from CNN, or anywhere in between, is a distorted reality. Because the Muslims don't have the confidence to connect with Allah and the Quran, they live on a distorted reality. But there are three souls in this world. And then, the fact, and to see the issues as they are, these qualify more for Allah's guidance and Allah's word than those who are overdosing on cultural Islam, or traditional Islam, or ritualistic Islam, or this other type of Islam that has rendered us in the rut that we have been in the previous generation, and who become apologetic to the Kuffar and Mushrikeen, and seek recognition in the Kuffar and the Mushrikeen. The Muslims have gone out of their way to designate the 14th or 15th of this coming September as voter registration day. Imagine this, brothers and sisters in Islam. They want us, the Muslims, to sign on to platforms of kufr and shirk and zulm in this world, as if we were class and independent, self-sufficient, self-fulfilling Islam. Our Islam has been reduced to the Saudi version of things. Not many people want to speak out against it. And once again, you take a closer look, and it's a crisis of conscience. And it's a crisis of confidence. That is what the average Muslim is suffering from. And when it comes to the military establishments of kufr and shirk, they want to bow down. They want to bend down. They want to prostrate themselves mentally and psychologically. And then they hypocritically bring their bodies to prostration in front of Allah. How hypocritical! Their minds and their spirits are prostrating themselves to kufr and shirk, and their physical bodies are prostrating themselves to Allah. Only in limited moments of the day, and the rest of it belongs to the Mushrikeen and the Kafirin of the world. These are ways that emanate from the religious establishment in Mecca and in Medina. And on this day, from year to year, from Jum'ah to Jum'ah, are one and vain about these issues. They don't want to speak about them. They don't want to bring it to the attention of the Muslim public. And the Kafirs and the Mushriks can get away with their war of genocide and attrition, their external war, their induced civil war. They want to get away with all of that and our so-called scholars continue to babble in a litany of ritualistic, meaningless words every Friday, and Muslims are paying dear with their lives and their blood and their sweat, while being begging on, begging their clothes, void in their minds, pure pride every Jum'ah, at this time, almost everywhere around the world. And this matter is not going to go away. It is increasing, and it shall increase until when Allah wills it, and wisdom comes along. وَيَوْمَ إِذِ يَفْرَحُ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ بِنَصْرِ اللَّهِ يَنْصُرُ مَنْ يَشَاءُ إِنَّ اللَّهَ قَوِيٌّ عَزِيزٌ أَقُولُ قَوْلِي هَذَا وَأَسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهَ لِي وَلَكُمْ وَادْعُوهُ سُبْحَانَهُ وَأَنْتُمْ عَلَى يَقِينٍ بِالْإِجَابَةِ وَتُوبُوا إِلَى اللَّهِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ هُوَ التَّوَّابُ الرَّحِيمُ. الحمد لله رب العالمين رب الأولين والآخرين رب المظلومين والمستضعفين. We say الحمد لله and we mean الحمد لله. There are many bodies in services of Muslims over which this word is proclaimed throughout the centuries and throughout the generations. Throughout our contemporary world, from different lands to different continents, with the fire igniting in our homeland, in our territory. With all of that in mind, we say and we declare, Alhamdulillah. We shall not succumb. If they come to us and then say, we are fanatic, we will tell them we're not fanatic. We are people with a single-minded purpose. If they come to us and they say, you are backward, we say, we are not backward. Our prophet is located 1,400 years ago in history, and we take pride in this relationship to him over 1,400 years in time. If they tell us and accuse us of being stubborn, we tell them, we are not stubborn. We want what every decent human being is entitled to have, and that is freedom and dignity. And we say all of this with humility, and we say all of this with the presence and a concentration on the reality of Allah in our hearts and in our hands. This is another area that they approach the Muslims from. They want us to think that by conceding to negotiations, we are civilized. We tell them no. We will not concede to negotiations on your terms. We have a lot to answer for. In Islamic history, the Muslims defeated the Crusaders who stole the Holy Land from its occupants and its native population. They forget about it. Remember, these are the liberals. These are the open-minded, the civilized, the modernistic people. 8 centuries after that, one of their generals stepped up to the grave of Salah ad-Din, kissed Salah ad-Din's grave and said to him, a European general from the depths of Europe after 800 years, he says that I have been now the crusades have come to an end. Why did the Muslims provide the staff for a vicious general to boot the Muslim of Salah al-Din and say, it is now that the crusades are over? And if this crisis of confidence and crisis of conscience continues, there will come a day when a Yahudi general will go up to the prophet's grave. He will kick the prophet's grave and tell him, now Khaybar is over. And these types of imams on the minbar, these preachers and scholars are contributing to that by making believe none of this happens or none of this is happening. Our conscience and our consciousness will be ignited by those who precede us to Allah through their sweat and through their blood. Never as a Muslim, especially in today's hostile world, never forget that fact. اللهم أرنا الحق حقا وارزقنا اتباعه وأرنا الباطل باطلا وارزقنا اجتنابه ولا تجعله ملتبسا علينا واجعلنا للمتقين إماما. اللهم إليك نشكو ضعف قوتنا وقلة حيلتنا وهوانا على الناس. يا أرحم الراحمين أنت ربنا وأنت رب المستضعفين، فإلى من تسألنا؟ إلى غريب يتفهمنا أم إلى عدو لم نحسب أمرنا؟ إن لم يكن بك علينا غضب فلا نبالي، ولكن عافيتك هي أوسع لنا. نعوذ بنور وجهك الذي أشرقت له الظلمات وطلق عليه أمر الدنيا والآخرة، من أن تنزل بنا غضبك أو تحل علينا سخطك. لقد عدت حتى ترضى، ولا حول ولا قوة إلا بك. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وآل إبراهيم، وبارك على محمد وآل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وآل إبراهيم في العالمين، إنك حميد مجيد. والعصر، إن الإنسان لفي خسر إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر. ومن أظلم ممن منع مساجد الله أن يذكر فيها اسمه وسعى في خرابها، أولئك ما كان لهم أن يدخلوها إلا خائفين، لهم في الدنيا خزي ولهم في الآخرة عذاب عظيم. إن الله يأمركم أن تؤدوا الأمانات إلى أهلها، وإذا حكمتم بين الناس أن تحكموا بالعدل، إن الله يعين يعظكم به، إن الله كان سميعا بصيرا. ولذكر الله أكبر، والله يعلم ما تصنعون. وأقم الصلاة، إن الصلاة كانت على المؤمنين كتابا موقوتا.
الله أكبر الله أكبر لا إله إلا الله.
Looking straight line, shoulder to shoulder, and heart with heart. صلوا الصلاة الموجهة pray as if it's your concluding prayer.
Allahu Akbar.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا صراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. إن فرعون علا في الأرض وجعل أهلها شيعا يستضعف طائفة منهم يذبح أبناءهم ويستحيي نساءهم إنه كان من المفسدين. ونريد أن نمن على الذين استضعفوا في الأرض ونجعلهم أئمة ونجعلهم الوارثين ونمكن لهم في الأرض ونري فرعون وهامان وجنودهما منهم ما كانوا يحذرون. الله أكبر. سمع الله لمن حمده. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إذا جاء نصر الله والفتح
ورأيت الناس يدخلون في دين الله أفواجا فسبح بحمد ربك واستغفره إنه كان توابا. الله أكبر. سمع الله لمن حمده. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله.
ولا صبرك إلا بالله ولا تحزن عليهم افرغ علينا الصبر وثبت أقدامنا وانصرنا على القوم الكافرين. ربنا وسعت كل شيء رحمة وعلما فاغفر الذين تابوا واتبعوا سبيلك وقهم عذاب الجحيم. ربنا وادخلهم جنات عدن التي وعدتهم ومن صلح من ابائهم وازواجهم وذرياتهم انك انت العزيز الحكيم. ربنا افتح بيننا وبين قومنا بالحق وانت خير الفاتحين. ربنا عليك وحدك توكلنا واليك وحدك انبنا واليك وحدك المصير. ان الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا ايها الذين امنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وآل إبراهيم وبارك على محمد وآل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وآل إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد. والعسر إن الإنسان لفي خسر إن الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر. ومن اظلم ممن منع مساجد الله ان يذكر فيها اسمه وسعى في خرابها اولئك ما كان لهم ان يدخلوها الا خائفين. لهم في الدنيا خزي ولهم في الاخره عذاب عظيم. إن الله يأمركم أن تؤدوا الأمانات إلى أهلها وإذا حكمتم بين الناس أن تحكموا بالعدل إن الله يعين يعظكم به إن الله كان سميعا بصيرا. ولذكر الله أكبر. اذكروا الله يذكركم والله يعلم ما تصنعون يعلم السر واخفى. واقم الصلاه ان الصلاه تنهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون.
اهدنا الصراط المستقيم
وعلى طعامه المسكين فويل للمصلين الذين هم عن صلاتهم ساهون الذين هم يراءون
الله أكبر سمع الله لمن حمده الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر السلام عليكم ورحمة الله السلام عليكم ورحمة الله
وهو على كل شيء قدير